Good morning, church. Welcome to worship here at University Mennonite Church. We're glad that you are able to be here with us. Whether you're here in the building or meeting on Zoom, we are glad to be together. We gather together to worship amid the ongoing winter season, although with today's sunshine and milder temperatures, it's hard to believe that we are in the midst of January right now. We're fortunate, Pastor Kate has begun her sabbatical time, but we're fortunate to have Bonnie Kline Smeltzer here with us. Bonnie was the pastor at University Baptist and Brethren Church for 20 years, recently retired, and a wonderful colleague and mentor and friend of mine. I'm really glad to have Bonnie here as our preacher here this morning. We begin our service this morning with our prelude video, and I just want to say a continued thank you to all of you who have contributed to that during these last 2+ years of the pandemic season. I know it has enhanced my life and enhanced our worship time together to have these photos and videos sharing in each other's lives. So at the back, whenever you're ready, please go ahead and share our prelude video as we begin our service this morning. Good morning again. Our service continues our congregational journey that we had begun last Sunday with a passage from Romans, the 12th chapter. It's fitting to have a service about transformation this morning, the theme of our service, as churches around the world are celebrating World Anabaptism Sunday today. In January of 1525, just about 500 years ago, the first Anabaptists met and performed adult baptism, an act at the time of civil disobedience based on their transforming understanding of what it meant to follow Christ. You'll see themes of transformation throughout our service this morning, from the music that we've chosen, the scripture, to Bonnie's sermon. We hope you savor this space as we reflect again about what it means to follow Jesus Christ together, to be transformed in that space. As we continue our time together, I invite you to join me in the call to worship found on the screen or in our bulletin here this morning. We gather once again to worship. Called away from the customs and attitudes of the world around us, standing up or speaking out, or sometimes being quiet.
Leave us people together in this place.
May what we do here together strengthen our faith and help us discern how to be witnesses to the way of love and compassion, of justice and peace that Jesus showed us. Here at University Mennonite Church, we light a peace lamp each week. We've done so for many, many years, since the start of the Iraq War. We light it each week, prayerfully longing for God's peace in our world. We know that there are many broken pieces of peace in our world. A news broke, Bonnie shared with me this morning, that at a Lunar New Year celebration last night in Los Angeles, another mass shooting occurred, shaking us from the peace that we long for. We long for God's presence to rebuild and to make sense of a world that feels so chaotic. We think of those suffering today, waking up to news that their loved one is no more. We think about those still suffering from flood damage. We think about those who are living amid the ongoing unrest in the Ukraine. We think about the various political tensions around the globe, even here in our country, and those who continue to struggle with injustice in all of its forms. We also lament the way that our actions can contribute to these tensions, that things we do sometimes lead to a lack of peace. And we invite God's peace in the midst of that turmoil, which is so hard to make sense of. We long for peace in our hearts. We long for peace in our community. We long for peace in our world. I ask you to join me in a prayer as we begin our time together this morning. Creator God, when we reflect on the peace in our lives and in our world, our hopefulness can become grounded by fear. When we reflect on our actions, our confidence becomes shaken. We ask that through our weakness we might find strength and peace in you. Send us your peace so that we may be your light in the world. Amen. We continue our time of worship this morning with some congregational singing led by Hal this morning. Hal and Faith. Thank you, Faith.
Please rise as you are able, and you might note that the number in the hymn book or in the announcement is wrong.
We read hymn number 555. Lord, I am fondly, earnestly longing.
Thank you.
Bethany will be leading our children's time this morning, so I invite our children forward at this time.
Alicia, Jonas, Timo, Ben, Daniel. It's good to see you up here. So, today, if you listen to Ben and Bonnie, you might hear them talking about making peace, about loving enemies. So I have two stories for you about that this morning. The first story comes from about 300 years ago in Switzerland, and it happens in a house where a preacher named Peter, there's the doorbell, preacher named Peter and his wife Anna were sleeping peacefully. And all of a sudden, they heard some sounds on their roof. And Peter woke up and he said, "Oh dear, what's going on? Something's on my roof." So he got a lantern and he came down the stairs and he came outside and he looked up at the roof, and sure enough, there were people up on the roof and they were trying to break into his house. Now, Peter was a pastor in a small town in Switzerland, and he was a pastor who was preaching that Jesus loved all of us and that Jesus called us to love our enemies and to lay down our weapons. And that was not a very popular teaching at that time and in that place. So these people were coming to do harm to Peter and his wife, Anna. Well, Peter saw the people up on his roof and he knew what they were up to. And so he prayed and he said, "God, what should I do? Help me to be wise. Help me to follow your ways of peace." Peter had an idea. So while the people were on his roof, he went back upstairs and he found Anna. And he said, "Anna, will you help me? Will you help me make a meal?" Anna quickly realized what was happening. So the two of them went down to the kitchen and they put some wood on their fire and they cooked a really nice meal and they set the table. Peter fell down.
This one's the kitchen.
You're right. There we go. That's the kitchen.
There's a pot.
So they set a table filled with food. And then Peter went around outside again and he said, "Friends, up on the roof, I'm sure you're tired after all your work. Why don't you come inside and eat with us?" People on the roof, what do you think they felt?
They were very confused.
They're probably confused, but they listened to Peter and they came inside.
Well, they're having apples.
And they all gathered around the table and they shared a meal. Afterwards, Peter and Anna were surprised to see that the people went back up on the roof. And they were making noise up there again. And Peter and Anna thought, oh no, our plan didn't work. And they went outside and looked, and they realized that the people on the roof were repairing their roof. They were repairing the damage that had been done. So that was the way that Peter and Anna, 700 years ago, were peacemakers. I'm going to tell you one more story.
You said 300.
Did I say 700 years? 300 years ago. This would have been in the 1700s. That's where I got mixed up.
There's a bell on the top. That's
it. We have a bell on this one, too. Check this out. This is a school. And this is a story. This is a story about a girl. This is actually, I did want it backwards because we have two schools in the story. So this is a story about a girl named Natalie. And this story about Natalie is from only about 10 years ago. So Natalie was going to a new school. She was in seventh grade. And there were some bullies at her school. Do you guys know what bullies do?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if you have any at your school.
Do
you in your grade? Boys, do you have any bullies in your school?
He's moving in January.
Ben.
He's moving by the end of January. Though.
Well, bullying is a problem in some schools where maybe they haven't found a way to help people live in peace. So
wait.
These two.
Does she see them?
This is Natalie. And this is at recess, and maybe the students come up and they push her. They called her names. This is what Natalie experienced. They called her names. One time, another girl even threatened her with some scissors. And this whole time, Natalie's parents were trying to help her. They were trying to reach out to her teachers, but the school wasn't really helping. So Natalie and her family decided that she was going to try a new school. She went to a new school. And the first day she was there, another student came up to her and he said, I think you're new. Do you need some help finding your way around? And for her, that one kind action completely changed the way she felt about herself and the way she felt at the school. She felt safe and she also felt like she was powerful and that she could help change the culture of bullying at her new school as well. So what she did is she talked with her dad, who was a software developer. You guys know about that. He made apps for phones.
6 o'clock.
So she and her dad together created an app. Do you guys know what an app is?
Yes.
Yeah. Something you have on your phone, an app called Sit With Us. And it was a way that students at any school, well, it started out at her school, but it later grew to many schools. An app called Sit With Us, where people could look on the app and see who in their cafeteria was being friendly that day and who was going to be a peacemaker, and would say, anyone who needs a spot can come and sit with us, sit at our table. And now that app has spread and it's being used in hundreds and thousands of schools around the world. So that was the way that Natalie decided to make peace and to bring, redeem the situation that she experienced of bullying. So we have Peter and Anna from 300 years ago, and we have Natalie from just a few years ago.
And now,
is that a true? Are they both?
They are both true stories.
Recess.
And I wonder. I wonder how you guys will be peacemakers. I want you guys to come and play with these after church because they are so fun. So I'm going to leave them up here, and after the sermon. You can come and play with these some more, all right? Let's have a prayer. You recognized it. Let's have a prayer together. Dear God, thank you so much for these stories, these admonitions from the Bible to make peace, and these stories of Peter and Anna and of Natalie. I pray that you will bless these students, these children, as they go out into the world and give them a sense of safety and a sense of their capacity for peace building. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Can I ring the bell into the microphone?
Maybe after church. Sorry.
Romans 12, the Message Translation. So here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for Him. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what He wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you.
I'm speaking to you out of deep gratitude for all that God has given me, and especially as I have responsibilities in relation to you. Living then, as every one of you does, in pure grace, it's important that you not misinterpret yourselves as people who are bringing this goodness to God. No, God brings it all to you. The only accurate way to understand ourselves is by what God is and by what He does for us, not by what we are and what we do for Him.
In this way, we are like the various parts of a human body. Each part gets its meaning from the body as a whole, not the other way around. The body we're talking about is Christ's body of chosen people. Each of us finds our meaning and function as a part of His body. But as a chopped off finger or cut off toe, we wouldn't amount to much, would we? So since we find ourselves fashioned into all these excellently formed and marvelously functioning parts in Christ's body, let's just go ahead and be what we were made to be, without enviously or pridefully comparing ourselves with each other or trying to be something we aren't.
If you preach, just preach God's message, nothing else. If you help, just help. Don't take over. If you teach, stick to your teaching. If you give encouraging guidance, be careful that you don't get bossy. If you're put in charge, don't manipulate. If you're called to give aid to people in distress, keep your eyes open and be quick to respond. If you work with the disadvantaged, don't let yourself get irritated with them or depressed by them. Keep a smile on your face.
Love from the center of who you are. Don't fake it. Run for dear life from evil. Hold on for dear life to good. Be good friends who love deeply. Practice playing second fiddle.
Don't burn out. Keep yourself fueled and aflame. Be alert, servants of the Master, cheerfully expectant. Don't quit in hard times. Pray all the harder. Help needy Christians. Be inventive in hospitality.
Bless your enemies. No cursing under your breath. Laugh with your happy friends when they're happy. Share tears when they're down. Get along with each other. Don't be stuck up. Make friends with nobodies. Don't be the great somebody.
Don't head back. Discover beauty in everyone. If you've got it in you, get along with everybody. Don't insist on getting even. That's not for you to do. I'll do the judging, says God. I'll take care of it.
Our scriptures tell us that if you see your enemy hungry, go buy that person lunch, or if he's thirsty, get him a drink. Your generosity will surprise him with goodness. Don't let evil get the best of you. Get the best of evil by doing good.
It's my privilege again to introduce our speaker this morning. Bonnie Kline Smeltzer was the pastor at University Baptist and Brethren Church for 20 plus years. If you can imagine what it must be like to lead a congregation with two denominational ties, you will probably assume then that Bonnie is a person who understands how to bridge differences, but I also know her to be someone who is firm in what she believes and deeply committed to our Anabaptist Peace Church position. It's been great to know you, Bonnie, and to continue to have you here in our community, even though you are done with your time at University Baptist and Brethren as their pastor. During Pastor Marv's sabbatical several years ago, Bonnie stepped in and was the person who met with me on a monthly basis, and it's been great to have you here to help me be a better pastor and to learn from all the years of experience that you offer. Thank you for helping us continue to walk through Romans 12, and we look forward to what you have to offer us today.
I want to say what a joy it is to be here. I feel like this is a place where I feel kindred spirits for many reasons. I especially am so grateful for your pastor, Kate Heinzel. When she came here, I'm not sure how many years ago now, we would get together monthly for lunch. And then COVID hit, and we met weekly for 2 years. And longer, up until my retirement in July. Kate and Jess Cast and I think, would all say to you that we would not have survived COVID as pastors without the weekly support we had from each other. Just coming together, breaking bread, sharing what was happening in our congregations. How do you do Zoom? How do you do that? You know, we were all on new ground. And I am so grateful for Kate's friendship and the collegiality that we had and continue to have. I also want to say, Ben mentioned about the Anabaptism 500. My husband and I are actually in a Bible study for the Anabaptist Bible, where we're assigned several passages. We meet for 4 weeks, and hopefully some of our discussion will end up as notes in the Anabaptist Bible, so I'm grateful to be doing that. Will you pray with me? Holy One, we ask that you open our hearts and our minds to the word that you would have for us this day. Amen. Last week you had the scholar's version of Romans 12, and this week I wanted you to hear the whole thing read through the Message, which is a contemporary translation by Eugene Peterson, which I think helps put it in some other language for us to understand. I'm really working with the parts that talk about being transformed, although I did want you to hear the whole thing read. Paul begins this letter to the Romans, urging them to present their bodies as living sacrifices to God. And for Paul, sacrifice is a positive word. When he writes, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, he's inviting us to make an offering, to God. It is an act of consecration or dedication to the will and the work of God. Eugene Peterson catches this meaning well with his translation. So here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, your eating, your going to work and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing that you can do for God. This idea of living sacrifice, of making an offering of your life, reminds me of Gil Bailey's formative story of visiting with Howard Thurman around, I think it was 1973. And he went to Thurman struggling with some deep questions. What am I going to do with my life? What does the world need? Thurman's response was, don't ask yourself what the world needs. Ask yourself what makes you come alive, and go do that, because what the world needs is people who come alive. Have you ever noticed that alive spirit in a person who has found their passion? Ever noticed that in someone? Someone who's doing their life's work, who has found their calling. When I notice that aliveness in someone, it's usually because of some kind of transformation. The change is visible. It's as though something has just taken a hold of the person and is propelling them, their life forward with a passion and purpose. They're presenting themselves to God and the universe as living sacrifices. They are making an offering of their lives. So along with this invitation to present your everyday life to God as an offering, Paul also gives an admonition. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Here again, I want you to listen once more to Peterson's translation. Don't be so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what God wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. Well, I want to take a quick survey of those of you gathered here today, and you Zoomers, you can look at who raises your hands after I pose this question as well online. How many of you consider yourselves nonconformists? You can raise your hand or any body part just to be different if you need to be. Go ahead. How many of you consider yourselves put those hands up a little higher, nonconformists? Oh, less than I thought. Where are these Anabaptists? Well, I thought there would be some of you here today. In fact, I thought there'd be a few more, but you may be shy and timid. Nonconformists are people who are willing to be different because of their beliefs and their convictions, or out of principle, or for some out of whim, or just for fun. They're willing to stand up and stand out, or stand back from the crowd, from the status quo, and from enormous cultural pressure. That kind of nonconformist that Paul is talking about is a follower of Jesus that has been transformed. This is a person who is so alive in thought, word, and deed that he or she is willing to stand up for truth when others sit down. He is willing to take the heat for his convictions, and she is willing to walk into controversy and conflict in order to bring justice or peace. In a sermon on this same text, Martin Luther King Jr. coined the term transformed nonconformity. King observed how the pressures for cultural conformity to condition our minds and feet to move into the rhythmic drumbeat of the status quo are immense. Most people, says King, are thermometers that record or register the temperature of society, of majority opinion, not thermostats that transform and regulate the temperature of society. I've had, as I think many of you have, had the privilege of knowing some transformed nonconformists, some Christians who were thermostats instead of thermometers. My mother and father-in-law were such people. In 1942, when Executive Order 9066 was issued by Franklin D. Roosevelt, and Japanese Americans and Japanese who lived all along the West Coast were being relocated to internment camps, my in-laws were at the train station handing out lunches to friends and neighbors and strangers alike. They knew this was an inadequate response. So they quit their teaching jobs and they moved to Manzanar, to one of the camps, to be house parents and teachers living in the barracks with the internees. Even so, this they knew was still not enough. And after 6 months, they began resettling Japanese Americans in hostels in Chicago and Brooklyn because they knew it was safer the further they moved east. In a time of war when fear was rampant and patriotism meant not questioning any government action, much like today, this young couple dared to be transformed and share the love of God while they worked for justice. And I can hear my mother-in-law saying, until the very day she died, she was confounded why people made such a fuss over what she did in that time. For her, it was simply the right thing to do. And of course, it was. And they did it. As a youth, growing up in the Church of the Brethren, I experienced being transformed after attending a regional youth retreat. It was there that I received a full dose of Brethren teachings about our historic peace position. And while these teachings, they weren't really anything new to me, something changed inside of me. The peace position of the church was taught in my congregation and in my home by my mother and my father, who just so happened to be a disabled, retired Marine Corps veteran turned pacifist. His gung-ho Marine attitude was transformed into active peacemaking with a new uniform of varied peace t-shirts and a willingness to preach peace wherever and whenever he could. Because my father was a disabled vet, we all had military IDs, and they allowed us the same base privileges as the enlisted soldiers. So we shopped regularly at the commissary, which is a grocery store, and the PX, which is a small department store. And best of all, I remember many a summer day swimming at the pool at Fort Holabird in Dundalk, Maryland, southeast Baltimore. But I never once, with all those teachings, I never once questioned the use of any of these facilities until I went to the youth retreat. I returned from that retreat having claimed the peace position of the church in a new way for myself. I remember coming home convinced that I needed to turn in my military ID and talk with my father about why I was doing this. This was happening right at the height of the Vietnam War. And young men were burning their draft cards, and some were even going to prison for not cooperating with the selective service system, as I'm sure some of you experienced in the Mennonites church as well. I felt that turning in my military ID was the least thing I could do to separate myself from what I called the war machine. I felt that this was one way I could follow my Christian beliefs and not conform with the ways of war. And I tried to explain this to my father, but I don't think he ever really understood me. I remember him saying, "I earned those benefits for you." Indeed, he was disabled, he was blind in one eye and found it difficult to get work because of that disability. But more than his words, I remember the look on his face, the disappointment he felt that I would refuse a gift for which he made such a sacrifice. In that moment, I found myself being drawn in several different directions. There were different voices in my mind, struggling to be heard, trying to tell me what to do. There was the voice of the pleaser, telling me to be a good girl, don't make any waves. There was the voice of the parent. It was my mom telling me to be more understanding of my father, to put myself in my father's shoes. And add to that the voices of my peers, the other teens who had attended the retreat, who were cheering me on, telling me to carry out the peace witness we had learned about. I like to think that in the end, I listened to the voice of the Spirit and my true self. I believed the choice that I made was indeed my own, and after talking with my father and seeing his reaction to my decision, I changed my mind. I didn't turn in my military ID. I wanted to recognize my father's sacrifice, but I never used that ID again. I needed to honor the truth that had grown inside me. And I was at peace with this decision, and my father and I never talked about it again. Ever feel like you have different voices clamoring for your attention? They can be the external voices of family members, of colleagues, employers, and friends. And these voices often pressure you to conform to their thinking, or these voices, or the ways of the world. It's difficult not to know and not to bow to that kind of pressure, because they come from people you know, oftentimes people that you love and respect. But even if you were able to listen beyond these voices, to finally still your mind and find your own voice, you discover there are still internal voices that are crying out for attention. They're the voices like I heard, the parent, the peers, the pleaser, and many others. Baylor University neuroscientist David Eagleton observes that our brains are wired to be what he calls a team of rivals. Eagleton says, intuitively, it feels like there's a you. So when somebody meets someone they know, they feel like it's the same person, one person. But in fact, it turns out that we have under the hood a bunch of neural populations. Lots of neural networks that are battling to control our behavior. Eagleton continues, it's like a parliament in the sense that these different political parties might disagree with one another. They're like a team of rivals in that they all feel they know the best way to steer the nation, and yet they have different ways of going about it, just like different political parties do. This internal team of rivals means that it's getting harder to hear what our hearts and minds are saying because of all this noise in our brains. There are all kinds of voices vying for the floor, each one with its own expectations and advice. And we, as people of faith, we can add another voice to this team of rivals. It is the voice of the Holy Spirit, or the voice of God. Christians throughout time have tried to hear that voice, to know what God is calling them to be and do. Perhaps when you've faced a difficult decision, you've sought the counsel of colleagues or family and friends. And then as a person of faith, you've even prayed about the decision, hoping that with the wisdom of others, you might hear that still small voice of God offering guidance and wisdom. Or as Paul says, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Well, friends, the the Christian mystics like Teresa of Avila, Hildegard Bingen, and Thomas Merton, they all found ways to still the voices and distractions in their lives and to find that place in their heart or that peace in their mind to encounter God, the holy and the sacred. And by doing so, their lives were transformed. In every day, in every time, we are given opportunities to be transformed. As followers of Jesus, as Christians, God calls us, continues to call us, to be different and to offer our lives to make a difference, to make an app, to make a meal. We're called to live by a different set of values and convictions. And when the world says bigger is better, we say stay simple and sustainable. When the world says grab it and keep it, we say give and share freely. When the world says war is the way, we say peace is Christ's way. And when the world says get revenge, we say forgive and forgive again and again. And then when the world says avoid all pain, numb yourself in a variety of ways, we say that the suffering we bear and walk through can be our greatest teacher. When the world says win no matter what the cost, we say count the cost and work for the common good. You know, as I know, being transformed nonconformist is not easy. Saying these things I've just said is easy. Doing them is not. Each one of us will have a different calling, and our individual callings and transformations can be woven together into that of a congregation, because congregations are also called to be transformed. As the community of faith here, known as University Mennonite Church, I believe you are called to create and continue to nurture a countercultural community of faith. You're called to support and nurture, and yes, sometimes even challenge one another, so that you can return to your everyday lives at home and school and work and retirement to be those living sacrifices, those offerings, those transformed nonconformists. So how can we do this? Eleazar Fernandez makes this suggestion. If a free flow of air is needed to make a fire, likewise a free flow of the spirit, ruach, air, is needed to form a church with a burning center and porous borders. Without the Spirit, we will not only have conformist churches, we will also have churches suffering from respiratory failures. If churches are not inspired by the Spirit, they will eventually expire. So we must pray the prayer of the early church. Veni Sancte Spiritus. Come, Holy Spirit. Will you pray with me? Come, Holy Spirit, blow your winds among us, lighting fires and stirring the embers of flame once more. Transform us and make us alive to our callings and your work in the world. Amen.
Thank you. love one another with mutual affection, outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord, rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Bless those. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Now if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they're thirsty, give them something to drink, for by doing so, you'll heap burning coals on their heads.
Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Do not be
Thank you. If there are visitors, we encourage you to introduce yourselves. There are mics on both sides or on Zoom. You can unmute yourself for that. Thank you for coming. Nice to have you here. Thank you to everyone for coming, both here and on Zoom. Are there any birthdays this week? No birthdays, anniversaries? Okay. Announcements. If the carpet looks a little cleaner or felt a little cleaner underneath your feet, that's because it was cleaned this week.
Laura Litwiller here. Wanted to get a group of people who might be interested in helping with the MCC meat canning. It's from February 6th to the 9th in Lewistown. Excuse me. And I called the folks at the canning committee, and mornings is a great time to have a group come. They need some morning workers, so if you do not have a job that makes you go out early in the morning and you're interested in joining a group, I'll be here after the service, and let me know. I've got some. Meat canning involves chopping meat, cleaning cans, packing meat in cans, labeling the cans, putting the cans in boxes, and then the food, 10% will stay local in central Pennsylvania, and the rest will go to places like Ukraine, Ethiopia, Cuba, Haiti, and other places where MCC partners are asking for meat to feed hungry people.
Thanks, Laura. Any others? Okay, Bonnie will give the benediction.
Transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit, work in your lives, in this community of faith as well, and in the world. Go now to bring forth hope and healing, peace and justice and joy to all you meet, even into the world. Amen.